So thanks for explaining all that. So I'm going to talk about tonight is smart contracts and why Haskell is particularly relevant to Haskell and smart contracts. So my main claim is that in the future we are going to write smart contracts very differently from the way we write them today. Today we do them in Ethereum in Solidity directly. I believe that that is too low level, and we're going to do contracts at a higher level and then compile it to Ethereum. So that's my basic premise. So, prior to last month, nobody really knew about this or cared about this. And then suddenly, there was this the DAO thing. You guys have all heard about this, right? Yeah, okay. And somebody, ran off with a few million dollars worth of Ethereum. And that got people very interested in the security of smart contracts. This was the message from the attacker. Very clever and slightly snarky, just the way I like it. And so people said, it turns out that Ethereum and the DAO have turned into the world's largest bug bounty program. So that was pretty funny. And a few days after that, Vitalik was like, okay, now we need to think about security. This is the funny thing about all software, right? Like, the life cycle of products is functionality, reliability, convenience, price, right? You compete on these frontiers: functionality, reliability, convenience, and then price. And none of these frontiers are about security. So we sort of shoehorn security into a system that we've already built. And that's the way things always will be. Because if you have two products, one of them cares about functionality first and is insecure, that's the one people are going to use. If you have another product that cares about security first and functionality second, nobody's going to use that. So this is just part of the human condition. Ever since the Garden of Eden, we've had to make this particular compromise. So Vitalik has gone and listed a number of classes of bugs that you can exploit in Ethereum. And if you take a step back and look at like why these bugs exist, right? And now people are saying, gosh, we need to have formal correctness. But why did these bugs happen in the first place? Software developers come from a culture where move fast and break things, right? Like, what's the worst that could happen? You write some code and then you load the web page and the web page doesn't quite work. So you go back and you write the code again and then it works the second time. You're like, all right, I fixed it. And if you're really responsible, you're like, okay, I'm going to check it on my phone now before I decide that it actually works. And it's like, oh, it works on my phone. Okay, let's commit. And then somebody else says, oh, it doesn't work on Android. And then you're like, oh, well, go and raise a bug report. Right? So that's the way people are. And that culture of software development has given us a world in which everything sucks all the time. Sometimes it's Amazon, like losing $66,000 a minute. Sometimes it's like the Japanese spacecraft that just went up last year, this
Wait,
year.
what bug was that?
Hmm?
That shouldn't have happened.
What shouldn't have happened?
I mean,
Yes.
I sort of had interest.
Yeah.
I mean, this.
I
There's so many
agree.
ones have, I mean, that's solved. So
It
what did they do
should
wrong?
be solved in theory, right?
Did the Japanese just fuck it up?
They fucked up.
Oh,
Yeah. Like,
okay.
even
More
the
than
Japanese can
fabulous.
fuck this up. They blew 286 million, right? So the DAO is like, that's only 100 million. Or, like a bunch of people died because back in the 80s, there was this life-critical computerized radiation therapy, and like it went wrong and it delivered 200,000 rads to this poor individual. And this happened several times. And so, the list goes on. The Mars Climate Orbiter is another example of how software screws up. And that's 120, all right? So that's like one DAO's worth of screw up.
The entire field of neuroscience, it turns out, it's
No, that was different. It wasn't a bug. That was an incorrect assumption about Gaussianity.
All
What
right.
we can talk about.
All right, so he has a PhD in MRI, so we'll get Virgil to
I
talk
mean,
about that
it was a
later.
flawed assumption, not a bug.
But look, like, there are all these bugs, right? And, like, baggage handling, they can't get it right. So you could go through and read this entire list of bugs. It's, like, pretty entertaining. And you would think that even the space guys would get it right, but sometimes they don't. So there's, you would think there are better ways to write software than this. And even Facebook is like, we need better ways to write software. So there are a number of solutions that the world has come up with. Like, at the bottom of the stack, Raygun, these guys, they're like, you're going to have bugs, and we're going to help you detect your bugs. And when your program crashes, we're going to find the crashes. So that's nice, right? But that's like, when your spacecraft crashes, we will tell you that your spacecraft crashed. It's like, okay, great, that's great, but how do we fix that ahead of time? And there are companies like Coverity that got by Synopsys, and they help to prove that your Pentium doesn't have a floating point bug, for example. And they do what's called static analysis. Is there anybody here who's familiar with static analysis? Okay, like three people. Okay, good. This is why there are bugs out there, right? So, like, reliability, verification, static analysis, this is a thing. And typically this is used for situations where once you've burned your code into the CPU, you can't upgrade the CPU. So they do it for hardware, for chips. Sometimes they do it for spacecraft. And Reddit is beginning to discover that maybe we should start using some of these techniques with Ethereum and finance software. And there's a great long thread up here where somebody summarizes like how these things don't work, how they're supposed to work, right? And the language itself guarantees that there are no bugs. And I can give you a really quick tour of some of the approaches and some of the ways to solve these problems. Like, for example, these guys are saying lots of Ethereum contracts ignore best practice recommendations, therefore you get this kind of bug. And how do you avoid these bugs? You can just not have the bug. And so they have gone and written a reviewer of all of the live contracts in the blockchain to try to identify this class of bugs. So that's kind of cool, right? Imagine being able to just look at all the contracts that are in the blockchain and find the buggy ones, and then you can exploit that. That could be your full-time job. So here's their automated analysis, pretty cool. I think it's a sign that we need a different approach. So just like manually saying, here's the best practice, let's not write that bug. Humans are way too fallible to do it this way, right? So this is a Haskell meetup, you're all Haskell programmers and you love types and you think there is a better way. So these people just put out a master's thesis on how to do safer smart contracts through type-driven development. Exactly what you would think, right? So Haskell is the way, or Haskell is kind of the approach. Here's another paper that just came out this month. Logic-based smart contracts for blockchain systems. So clearly there's a trend of thought in this direction. Okay, so is this interesting? Am I losing anyone yet? I'm just reviewing what I've discovered. So this, there's actually a strain of this work that goes back several years, even before the DAO, even before Ethereum. People have been thinking about smart contracts just in terms of like real world contracts. How do we, like, banks have option agreements and derivative contracts? These are actual contracts and they're electronic, even if they're not on the blockchain, they're real. So people have been thinking about this for a long time. And I think there's a good opportunity to connect the dots between these kinds of academic papers and the kinds of bugs that you're seeing in the real world and the approach that Haskell programmers are instinctively used to. So what kind of software does not have bugs? There's only one kind of software that doesn't have bugs, and it's called math. Are there any mathematicians in the room?
There are some funny examples.
That's true. But generally speaking, it's like if you can prove mathematically that your program does what it's supposed to do, then you have a leg up on top of the people who don't do that kind of proof. And that's why mathematicians are smug. You know, when I was an undergrad doing computer science, we were always terrified of the physicists. And the physicists were always terrified of the mathematicians. So I think that's just how it is. And, you know, translate that to software. I think this is the hierarchy of smugness. Is this roughly correct? Is this what you tend to think too? Like Haskell programmers are like morally superior to Java programmers, and then, you know, the JavaScript guys, they're like, okay, but they're morally superior to the C programmers, for example, because it's higher level, right? But it turns out that Haskell is only just like halfway up this hierarchy. Does anybody here program in Agda or Idris or Coq? Has anybody here heard of Coq?
So
yes.
I played with either, but I honestly cannot tell that I did really program in them.
Okay.
Because the moving part of these systems is so complicated. Actually writing a decent complex system takes a long time.
That's right. That's right.
The documentation for those systems is atrocious. But they make perfect sense.
Maybe what we need is a proof playground.
Yeah.
All right, how about that?
Good idea.
So,
I just want to make you aware that proving something correct is much different from exploring whether there is something that could work or even demonstrating that it could possibly work. Because design space is potentially infinite, and before you do anything that you can prove, you first need to have something working.
Well,
Go on.
So, I think the common method for you has learned over the years, maybe last year, is the idea of what's called post-mortem proofs. You write your program and then you try to prove that it's really working. This is really brute force, difficult, very hard to scale. And much better approach to actually design the program proof end in end. A mathematician will tell you the way you set up your definitions is half the work to do the proof. And the definitions, that's the program. And so, for example, at Nika, there's the first verified microkernel, you may have heard of that. SEL4, you want to type that in. And exactly that. And the way this proof was done was actually implementing the kernel in Haskell first. Why? Because that implementation allowed to play around with the system, but then abstract that declarative kind of specification into, in that case, the proof was done with Isabel, into the Isabel formalization, and derive manually by recoding the Haskell to C and efficient microkernel. And that way the two could be met up. And that's the reason why that was the first successful verification of the operating system. It's not that other people tried, but they always tried for something.
But
it,
so you it also, needs to you be also tell that there was a prototype.
Yeah, but the
and most programs ever end at the stage of prototypes in a way. You have proofs that something can work and you are happy with it.
But the prototype was done with the proof in mind.
This is secure design concept. If you did not start with your proof, you can't get above it, period. If you're trying to get a certain type of military or aerospace use, you definitely can't get a higher.
good. And that's a great thing about Acta. Acta lets you scale. You can write basically Haskell program in Acta, and then you iteratively you make the types much more precise. And in that way, the type is the proof. The type is the theorem, but the proof is the program in Acta. And you, by making types more rigorous, you can be more and more formal.
Yeah. So there's a whole book about this in Agda. So if you are attracted by this whole idea, you can read this book and get stumped by it. But I want to focus on one thing that you said. The type is the theorem and the proof is the program. Has anybody heard this idea before? So this idea is called the Curry-Howard isomorphism. And the Curry-Howard isomorphism relates the lambda calculus to functional programming, right? That's the reason we all have lambdas, right? And it's like people picked this random Greek letter and they're like, let's have anonymous functions be lambdas. So let me go back to, real quick, let me go back to where we were, right? So this hierarchy of smugness is actually a projection from the lambda cube. Have you heard of the lambda cube? So the lambda cube is basically like basic lambda functional programming languages are over here, and then you start adding features, and you add features, and you add features, and then you end up with something that is extremely morally superior and like way more smug. So for example, Coq is a proof assistant. This is what mathematicians use to write proofs, right? And then they're like, you know, we use Coq because Haskell is too low level for us. In fact, what we do is we compile Coq to Haskell. So they start all the way up on the top right of the cube, and then they extract your OCaml or your Haskell program. And this is how you eventually turn it into C, and then you've got your verified microkernel or your spaceship or whatever you want to do. Start with the proof, then you turn it into program, and then you turn it into actual machine code. And along the way, you can witness that all these things maintain provable correctness. Another random thing that I came across was Z notation. So this is a language that you use to specify behavior rather than implement behavior. Most of what we do is implementation. If you can start with a specification, you should be able to extract an implementation from it. So this is, again, super math work. And in theory, you can start with Z and then pull things out of it. So really high-level stuff. Agda, Idris, and the Curry-Howard correspondence, this is the big idea, is start with the lambda calculus and you end up with functional programming. So keep this in mind because we're going to come back to it. So different programming languages, actually let me do this in here. So different programming languages have different kinds of properties, right? You can say, if we had a language with static types and we wanted it to support functional and object programming, then that programming language would be OCaml. And if all you got is like imperative programming, then you've got assembly language. If you've got logic programming, you get Prolog. All right, so this is kind of my quick list of different kinds of programming languages and the kinds of paradigms that they support. And if the paradigm is functional, well, functional corresponds to the lambda calculus. If you want to use the actor model, like Erlang, that actually has a different calculus. That's called the Pi calculus or the process calculus. And I believe, my assertion is that to do contract programming, and we're coming up with this language called L4, we're coming up with a new model of programming called contract programming or deontic programming, and the underlying calculus for that is the mu calculus. So there's a lot of Greek, it's all Greek to me. There's the lambda calculus, functional, the pi calculus, which gets you actor, and then the mu calculus, which gets you deontic. So this is the Curry-Howard correspondence as a translation function from an underlying calculus to a programming paradigm to a programming language. Does that make sense to everyone? You should be very comfortable with lifting and like high-level abstractions. So that's kind of where I'm at right now. Has anybody read this paper? This is one of the original Curry Howard correspondence papers back in 1965. This guy said, you know, looking at Algol, writing code in Algol, kind of feels like writing math using Lambda, and maybe these things are related. And it turns out that Algol supports the Lambda calculus. Lisp also took this idea. So let me zoom out from the whole calculus programming language thing for a minute. Even back before Ethereum, back before the DAO, people have been talking about how to write computable contracts. Just general purpose, like real world contracts. I'm going to rent an apartment, or I'm going to sell you a thing and you're going to buy a thing, or we're going to do an investment agreement for a startup. These kinds of contracts, whether or not they live on the blockchain, it should be possible to represent them computationally. This guy's called Balaji, and Balaji has been saying, you know, maybe we should go and computerize all this stuff. Let's encode simple business contracts before we do DAOs so that we get the foundations right. So that's kind of an interesting idea, right? At Stanford, they've been thinking about this. They have the Computable Contracts Project, and they've been saying, you know, we need to start with a language, and then we need verification, and then we need analysis and implementation. So how do we extract a real-world contract out of a contract description language? So all these ideas are out there. And so in the legal domain, in legal tech, you get this equivalent XKCD. And again, it ends up in mathematics. And so what is this mu calculus, right? We know what the lambda calculus is. The mu calculus, the modal calculus, deals with, I'll just let you read this because it makes more sense. So the deontic logic is one application of the mu calculus. If you look at the calculus, it has the box operator and it has the diamond operator. And in the case of a deontic application of the mu calculus, box means you must do something and the diamond means you can do something. It's possible to do other forms of a modal calculus, such as a temporal application. So let's see. So temporal logic, where time is your world. It's like, I am always hungry is your box, and then I will become hungry at some point in the future is your diamond. So this is another application. So you want deontics. So let me open up deontic logic. So deontic logic is relevant to contracts because you say somebody must do something or somebody may do something. And that is the basis for your calculus. You can say somebody must not do something. Somebody must do something, somebody must not do something, right? That's your negation. To say that somebody may do something is equivalent to saying that it's not true that somebody must not do something. So that's your not, which turns into permission. All right, so this is a different calculus that lets you think about what you are supposed to do. And in both cases, both the temporal and the deontic logics make use of crypt key semantics. Right, so I must do something, and you must do something, right? I pay you some money, and you give me a thing.
Well, no, because it's not, they're not making
That's right. They're, instead of being prerequisites, they're co-requisites. So it is. It turns out that it is possible to model this, right? It's like A has to be true and B has to be true, else you have some sort of breach or reparation scenario. So let's look at, so this is, I'm just introducing the idea of a modal logic being the basis for some kind of contract language, right? In the same way that the lambda calculus is the basis for functional programming, I think the modal mu calculus will be the basis for contract programming. And that is the piece that's missing from Ethereum and the DAO and sort of today's software. They're all basically doing the equivalent of assembly and JavaScript when they should be doing the equivalent of Haskell and Coq. Right. So lots of Greek. I put the Greek down here. So that's kind of my argument. Where was I? So very recently, people have been doing PhDs on this. So this PhD just came out a few years ago, contract formalization and DSLs. So very exciting. And he uses a variant of deontic logic to represent obligation, because that's the core expression. And this is what a contract is. Basically, if you want to encode contracts, then you say a clause in a contract is either trivially fulfilled or, and this is the big one, under some circumstance, some actor has to perform some action within a certain amount of time. And if they do that, then you recursively go to a different clause. And if they fail to do it, then you recursively go to a failure clause, right? So this is the logic. I'll just let you read this.
So if you go back, maybe I will explain the modalities.
Okay, let's just read this paragraph first, so that everybody gets the English language version. And then, if you want to explain the modalities, where is the modal logic in this?
You see here is a fragment of just a normal logic, positional logic, which means that you have and or. I don't see. Oh, there is also this expression, the negation, yeah, and variables. So that's pretty much apparent that it works the same way. And then these logical statements can be embedded in the modal statements on top. So we have either fulfillment, so the contract has been satisfied, or the obligation, so something has to be done by somebody until certain time, or two types of choices. One is that you make the choice or contract makes the choice. So if the amount due is more than $1,000, then you give the receipt, otherwise maybe not. And there is external choice, which means that somebody else makes a choice and you need to adapt to it. So you need to give somebody a choice. It's like the options on the financial markets, that you can have an option that gives you right to have a choice or the other way. And again, there is the temporal aspect, which means that something happens either after a certain time or meanwhile.
So this relates both deontics and temporal modals in this language. And the claim is that this language is sufficient to take any real-world contract and translate it into a formalism that can be proved. And you can take your real-world contract, formalize it, and then say, here are all the bugs in your contract. It is not a total contract because there are so many code paths where you just have like a null pointer or it's undefined, right? And I'm sure we've all read contracts where it's like, we're gonna do something and you're gonna do something and that's your happy path. And there's like, there's no exception handling. And if it fails, you just breach, right? And then you have a lawsuit. So if we can have better exception handling in contracts where you're like, I do something, you're supposed to do something, and if you don't do that something, then we actually handle that scenario, then there are gonna be fewer lawsuits, right? Really simple idea. So all of this stuff is actually available on the internets. So the guys who did this contract specification language have all of this done in Haskell. So it's all there. What we want to do next is take this basic language and see if we can compile it to Ethereum. We want to see if we can prove it in something that's closer to AGDA. I mean, this AGDA and Haskell are actually very close. So maybe we can upgrade this to AGDA, and then we can verify it. So we want to compile it to Ethereum. We want to run formal proofs. And we also want to compile it to English. So there's this thing called Attempto Controlled English. And Attempto Controlled English is a formal language. Which means that there should be some kind of Turing equivalence between your contract written in Haskell or AGDA and this English language contract. So you should be able to extract lengthy legalese from L4. Does that make sense? And if you can extract it to English, you should also be able to extract it to Chinese, right? Starting with the same source code. And then it becomes really cool to have bilingual contracts, because that is a multi-billion dollar industry in itself. If you want to do business across country boundaries, you usually have to have multiple languages. So this is something that, like, Europe should get excited about. So these are the goals of the project. We want to write this DSL, the extension of the what we've just looked at. We want to do formal methods on it. We want to turn it into English and other languages, and we want to turn it into Ethereum. So that's kind of the project, and I'm putting this out there because, you know, I think that if all of this is possible, then in the future, this is how people are going to write contracts. And I open it up to discussion. Does this make sense? Can you poke any holes in this argument? Does it sound like nonsense? Or do you know of anything that makes all of this like irrelevant or obsolete or wrong? Or not even wrong? Because if we're not wrong, then in a few years, probably contracts will be written in this. And that's going to be the bulk of smart contract development, both on the blockchain and off the blockchain. It's only a few years away, just like AI.
So yeah. In your opinion, that's the migration, like, from the existing, like, real-world contract will be a smooth migration to the Ethereum formal language contract. Because for, like, for example, the JavaScript and somebody trying to compile some better language to JavaScript, but people still might not use those better language to, but instead use the, like, most language.
Yeah, the thing that will really encourage them to get it right is that we'll be able to find their bugs and exploit them, basically. So, yeah,
I'm
this.
Sure, lawyers get upset when there's political, legislative, or other means to try to be on. Several kinds of lawyers.
Yes. So, the question was, what happens when the lawyers decide that we are intruding on their business? So.
I think it's less relevant. The lawyer business is not about writing contracts itself, it's about providing certain quality and assurance about the consistency with the law. So judgmental part can be a separate topic, whether it's consistent with Singapore law.
Yeah, like look at a law firm, right? A law firm is really wedded to the idea of doing all this stuff by hand. Why? Because the corporate side, right, they've got a whole bunch of lawyers writing contracts. And then they have an equal number of lawyers doing dispute resolution. And there is a correlation between these facts.
So to a certain extent, I think you will have an easier time with smart contracts or viewing or something like that, because the interface problem basically, I mean, obviously, it's definitely possible to have a DSL or ESL or whatever. Easy, but it's clear it can be done, and of course the contracts in the blockchain are that's the contract, and there's nothing else. I think it's clear that this is possible. The question is how hard is it. With the real world contracts, the problem is the interface. So the contract doesn't live in a void, but for example, translating contracts between Chinese and English, the problem is the contract will China would be interpreted in the context of Chinese law, and in Singapore, Australia, wherever, interpreted in that nation's legal context, which will be different. So the same thing will mean different things. And that's actually, I mean, taking your correlate or your analogy you played with formal methods a step further, that is actually a problem that formal methods also encounter. In the formal software, everything is clear because everything is specified and so on. But then, for example, take L4, the verified microcode. It is really, I mean, as far as the specification goes, this thing is not going to go wrong. 100% sure. There's not a single bug in the implementation. But the operating system needs to be booted. Oh, but nobody verified. And how about bugs in the hardware and so on? I think with legal contracts, which are not in smart contract environment, we get the same. I'm not saying this is breaking the idea, but the friction where you have to interact with non-formalized things because, well, that happens to be the law in the country. It's working.
Yeah, and we see exactly this idea, even in the tradition of law, where some countries have a constitution and they have legislation, and other countries just have common law and case law, right? And so one is more formal than the other. And you can put these things on a spectrum. But I think it is also possible for people to say, look, we as private parties choose to subscribe to this infrastructure as opposed to that infrastructure. In the same way that a lot of people choose to run Linux or OS X or Windows, right? You choose your operating system. And so it may be possible to just import like enough libraries to basically have your own private set of a private interface layer that abstracts away the underlying country. Right, it becomes a localization problem, internationalization problem. So I think that might happen in the future. Who knows? It's possible to use L4 to write contracts. It's also possible to use L4 to write regulations. Right. So, you know, implementing a contract for a particular jurisdiction basically is another import line in your module. So, you know, there are, if you look at what legislation actually looks like, you see variable definitions, you see function calls, you see anonymous functions, you see if then else case statements, right? And all of this stuff looks exactly like something that you'd want to put curly braces around or give it some indentation and just turn it into a function with proper types, right? This is something that actually goes back a long, long ways. So if you go back to 1986, the Nationality Act, that basically says, are you a citizen? Depends on whether your parents were citizens, where were you born? Were you born in a country that was a British colony at the time when you were born, right? So they wrote a prologue program to solve for whether someone is a British national in 1986. So it should be possible to apply this kind of thinking to smart contracts, Haskell, 30 years later, right? So any other thoughts, comments? Is anybody interested in working with us on this, whose day job doesn't prohibit them from doing so? So we are, there's a very small team of people working on this project, legalese.com. Yeah.
Do you think that the DAO hacker should keep his money?
Yeah.
Actually, I do think so.
Yeah. Who here thinks that the DAO hacker should not be able to keep his money? And who here thinks that the DAO hacker should keep his money? Right. You're all like strongly into rule of law.
I would say I'm in the third camp. I have serious doubt.
Okay.
Whether it's enforceable for taking the kid's money away from him. The first, it's totally virtual. It's all in ethers.
Mm-hmm.
And the second thing, it has been contracted, so.
I think there are also instances where the regulators are intentionally keeping their laws vague.
Yeah.
So they
don't really want to
be clear or anything. EU, that's Vitalik. It could really be a toggle between the two. It could be two buttons.
Right.
It should be like a
yeah.
The EU generates directives to member states.
Yeah, so
there is also the obligation on the part of either the parliament or the whoever issues the legal act and the judge that before any interpretation or any specifics, there is the intent of the law declared. And in many jurisdictions, the fact that intent has ceased to matter means that the executive act is also ceasing to matter in many cases.
This is very, very important in some legal. Well, I suspect Brussels is going to learn this later this year, but certainly what tends to be an anchor board is that lower courts can't consider intention where they've got clear and legal instructions on the kind of hearing the.
That may be here. Common law, because it's based on the custom. But if you go into the civil law, like in most of your countries. That's enough.
Once you step a couple of levels of higher, then it becomes permissible, potentially obligatory, to look at whether the act of law, as written, implements the intent of the legislature. So the US Supreme Court spends all its time on that, the Supreme Court, so it can be interpreting this one out of 50 short. spend a fair bit of time on that. And it's, if they absolutely, you get to the point where, like, okay, now we look at, does this instrument achieve what the legislators were trying to achieve? That's a whole, that's my other, perhaps, answer to your question about what might unstick this for me. Is that the, we are so dependent on a bunch of assumptions about how much the judiciary can undo when it comes down to the go quite the plan, that large sudden changes in scope likely to cause difficulties. And those difficulties might turn into unenforceability, or they might turn into markets recoiling terror, or whatever. It's hard to miss. This is a software engine, so.
Yep. So, I don't want to get too far into philosophy, but you can, I think, I'm going to suggest a couple of ideas. Are there any philosophers in the room who can explain to me the difference between intentionality and extensionality? If not, I will just make up my answer, which is that extensional logic has to do with things that are like objectively evident in the real world. So it's like, we can say, I have a dollar and I'm going to hand you a dollar, right? And intentional logic sort of has to do with things that are not quite so obvious and not quite so objective. So we might say intentionally, I am an immoral person, or I am guilty, or I will be guilty at some point in the future. Right? These are less objective ideas. And so what we're really saying with the Dao attacker is, a lot of people would say, look, even if the Dao attacker keeps his money, I am not going to deal with this person. I am going to shun that person because I don't want to take their money because these are ill-gotten gains. And that takes us all the way back to like the 17th century Amish who decide that they don't want to interact with this person, right? And that's a kind of intentional consequence, right? The attacker got the money. That's an extensional truth. But nobody likes the attacker, and that's an intentional result. And by trying to tweak the DAO and appeal to Vitalik and like basically hack Ethereum so that we can undo this, we're trying to translate an intentional situation to an extensional situation. My proposal is that, if you think about it, on Medium, everybody can have their own blog, right? On YouTube, everybody can have their own TV channel. My proposal is that everybody should have their own currency, which is not such a crazy idea. If you think about it, like the stock market, every publicly traded company has their own currency, right? And it's like whatever your share symbol is. So if it's possible for every publicly traded company to have its own currency, if it's possible for every country to have its own currency, then why shouldn't every individual have their own currency? And the consequence for the DAO attacker is that even though they can make off with like $20 million worth of Ethereum, the exchange rate suddenly goes like this, and all of the Ethereum that they have converted to their personal currency is now worthless, and all of the value stays in the original currency. That is, I think, the crypto way to relate intentional to extensional, without having to go and hack the DAO.
So you can only spend your own currency?
You can spend your own currency, and you can trade your currency with people who are willing to trade with you. So it'll be like those lame PGP key parties, right? But like in the blockchain. And the state that you live in, the fiat currency, might be legally obliged to trade with you. So you always have, like if you're a nation, if you're a national of some country, then you have to be able to interconvert with Singapore dollars. So that might be one future scenario. But we're kind of getting a little far away from smart contracts, but I think that is the right long-term solution.
But that's, you are put up.
Yeah.
In terms of the real world,
okay.
We, as I think, have a strong system that consistently renders profoundly uninvested outcomes invisibly profoundly uninvested outcomes in the system itself, which is not as important as it is.
Speak up. So, yeah.
Where are the safety valves? That was the thing.
I don't know.
And pointing back to my favorite topic, because the reason 150 was added to the is specifically that there's a broad generalization in the EU that there are complex systems without safety valves. So, and so it's not going to come in. Because without that, you get very, very, very bad outcomes.
Yeah. I don't have a good answer.
Well, I think you've suggested one really strong one is that you move the resolution out to the willingness of society to individuals to accept the fruits of what that person achieved, rather than attack the logic of the system that everything else is built upon. There are others.
Yep. So while I'm, you know, we're doing this like wild crypto anarchy excursion, I want to recommend that everybody go check this out. Moneyasdebt.net. And this is fundamentally like everybody that I've spoken to about this has not found a way to deny the fundamental fact that if you have a system in which interest exists, right? Imagine a closed world. There are 10 individuals, and then there is the bank. And the individuals go to the bank, and they say, we want to borrow some money, and we'll give it back to you after 1 year. And the bank says, great, we're going to do 10% interest. After 1 year, it's logical, I can logically guarantee that one of those people has to go bankrupt, right? Because it's a closed system. Well, the world is in fact a closed system, like the globe.
It has
gigawatts of energy. That's true. And we are not able to model that correctly with money, right? Because the monetary system that we have actually, like, when they borrow money, the bank actually creates most of that money out of nothing. That's fractional reserve banking. And then somebody has to pay back that money. And not everybody can pay back 10% interest because that money doesn't exist. And so every so often, Greece will go bankrupt. Individuals go bankrupt. Banks need to get bailed out. And the only solution is if, on average, banks charge 5% interest, then the global economy, GDP, has to go up by 5% every year. Or people go bankrupt. So this is another, like, fundamental issue that I think we're going to have to start thinking about. It's like the people who designed the system didn't really think it through.
They assumed they'd be worried that their vision was scoped to go over.
Yeah. So, you know, like thousands of years ago, people said, you know, they thought this through, and they're like, maybe that's not such a good idea.
That's why we have to converse to Islamic finance. And that'll be solved.
Then it'll be okay. So let's all switch to Islamic finance. Like, it's amazing what these guys, like, back in the day thought through, our Federal Reserve bankers aren't thinking about. So, anyway, any other thoughts about smart contracts, formal systems, Haskell, Agda, Idris? I hope I've inspired you to go and learn some of these, like, incredibly superior languages. And if you'd like to get involved in working on this with us, we are open to new developers coming and joining the project. In theory, we are going to work with some researchers from NUS and NTU and I2R. In practice, I think we will leave them in the dust relatively quickly, but who knows? Yeah. We will drag them. I hope so. No, like the universities actually have a lot of IP in informal methods. Just like getting it out of them is the challenge. So, yep. Chapter 10, Kripke semantics. Do you know who Kripke was? So all this stuff about like the modal calculus, really groundbreaking, really fundamental. Kripke did when he was about 19. True story. Yeah, yeah, he's like that young. So he wrote these two books when he was a teenager, and he basically invented the field of modal logic. That's why the calculus is called K after him. All right, well, thanks all. I think it's time for dinner. Hope that was useful. Do come and talk to me if you want to work on some of this. Goodbye.